Good morning, everyone. I welcome you all for this webinar on mental well-being of medical students during COVID-19. Following the presentation, if you have any doubts or any clarifications, you can ask me. The session will be open for discussion following the presentation. Okay. Please feel free to ask questions and doubts. Before going into the topic proper, let us have a brief history of this COVID-19 coronavirus. It was formerly known as 2019 novel coronavirus pneumonia. It originated from wet markets in Wuhan, Hubei province in China, in the early December 2019. I think most of you will be aware of it. By 7 January 2020, the Chinese Center for Disease Control and Prevention, CCDC, identified and named it as SARS-CoV-2, that is Severe Acute Respiratory Syndrome Coronavirus 2, which is transmitted via close contacts. By 23rd January in China, strict quarantine measures were adopted, especially in Wuhan and other regions, to prevent and control the disease epidemic. On 27th January 2020 onwards, emergency response was initiated in all provinces and autonomous regions and municipalities in China. And WHO declared COVID-19 outbreak as a global health emergency on 30th January 2020. The gentleman in the picture, you'll be aware of, is Dr. Meng Lihang Li, was a whistleblower who first declared the possible emergence of the severe acute respiratory syndrome pneumonia in China. He was one among the six Chinese health workers who died on 17th February 2020. By this time, more than 3,000 Chinese health workers were infected. By 18th February, there was 74,000 confirmed cases and 2,000 deaths worldwide. As far as India was concerned, we had the first case in Kerala on 20th January 2020. It was a medical student who returned from Wuhan, China. From 24th March 2020, government announced complete nationwide lockdown, and it has been extended thrice since then. And currently, we are in the lockdown 4. Almost more than 50 days we are in lockdown at present. The confirmed cases in India crossed 100 on 15th of March, and by month period, on 14th of April, it crossed 10,000. And by one second month, by 15th of May, it crossed the number of cases in China, and became more than 83. And the number of deaths crossed 1,000 on 29th April. As of yesterday, that is 18th May 2020, globally, the confirmed cases of COVID-19 are for more than 45 lakhs. And the confirmed deaths are more than 3 lakhs. And in India, the total cases has crossed 1 lakh by the end of yesterday. And Tamil Nadu has crossed more than 11,500 cases yesterday. The figures here are shown in the yesterday morning figures, around 10 o'clock. By end of yesterday, the figures of India crossed more than 1 lakh. So there are certain terms which we are exposed to quite often in the past 50 days or so. One is quarantine, other one is isolation, another one is social distancing. Quarantine is nothing but separation of people who have been exposed to the contagious disease to know whether they have become sick so that we can reduce the risk of them infecting others. So this is for people who are suspected to have the disease. Whereas isolation is done for people who are diagnosed to have this disease and they are separated from the general population so as to avoid transmission of the disease to healthy people. So quarantine is done for people who are suspected to have the disease, whereas isolation is done for people who have contracted the disease. Isolation can be either institutional isolation or home isolation. Institutional isolation is done in hospitals, whereas home isolation is the patient is asked to isolate himself in the confines of their home. Coming to the social distancing, this is nothing but certain measures that has been taken worldwide to stop or slow down the spread of this highly contagious disease. It includes limiting the large group of people coming together, closing down public buildings such as schools and universities, and cancelling public events. Presently, governments across the world and India are using combination of these measures to stop the spread of COVID-19 pandemic. So combination of lockdown and social distancing is what countries worldwide are employing to prevent the transmission of this disease from escalating. Okay. So, however, this quarantine, isolation, and social distancing can be a precursor for lots of mental health issues. Okay. So, the mental health issues during the COVID-19 outbreak are as follows. So, along with physical suffering, confirmed a suspected case of COVID-19 also suffer from psychological pressures and other health-related problems. They may experience fear, loneliness, denial, anxiety, depression, increased aggression, and sometimes even suicidal thoughts. The strict quarantine measures and mandatory contact tracing policies may lead to societal rejection, financial loss, discrimination, and stigmatization. So these isolated individuals may develop anxiety due to uncertainty about their health and may develop obsessive compulsive symptoms such as repeated temperature checking, repeated hand washing, sterilization, etc. And important aspect of this illness is there is very limited knowledge about the COVID-19, but there is overwhelming news about it which may lead to anxiety and fear in the public. The public may experience boredom, disappointment, and irritability because of this isolation and lockdown. Coming to the health professionals, many develop physical exhaustion, fear, anxiety, emotions, and sleep disturbances due to the excessive workload they are subjected to, the emotional and sleep disturbances they face with in their duty to care for the infected patients, close contacts, and sometimes also disseminating knowledge in the public. So, health professionals are severely stressed during this period of COVID outbreak. A recent study, which involved more than 1,500 health professionals, found that more than 50% of the population reported depressive symptoms, more than 44% had anxiety symptoms, and 36% have sleep disturbances. So, such kind of psychological disturbances are quite prevalent among the health professionals during this time. And the rapid transmission of this virus, persistent quarantine, and massive negative news about the growing number of confirmed and suspected cases and death are increase the likelihood of a person developing mental distress and psychiatric illness. So I will show you a couple of studies done on medical students, one in China, another one in Pakistan, to know the psychological impact of this COVID-19 epidemic on the medical college students. This study was done in Changzhi Medical College in China. In this study, almost 25% of the college students had experienced anxiety because of this COVID-19 outbreak. There are certain protective factors, however, like living in urban areas, living with parents, having a steady family income. They tend to have protective factor against a person developing anxiety, especially among these medical students. Whereas a person with a relative or acquaintance infected with COVID-19 had an increased risk factor of developing anxiety. And there are certain factors like economic stressor, effects on daily living, and academic delays. The fact that the clinical postings are all getting delayed, patients, they are not being exposed to the patients and not liable to learn through the clinical postings. And academic delays in the form of various lectures and classes, record works, etc., are positively correlated with the level of anxiety. Whereas students with good social support tend to have less amount of anxiety. At the end of the day, the study has suggested that mental health of the medical college students should be monitored during this epidemic. The next study, which was done in Pakistan, it was conducted in three universities in Karachi. hitting the title of this article was Concerns of Undergraduate Medical Students Towards an Outbreak of COVID-19. Here the study was done with 322 medical undergraduate students, among which almost 72%, 73% are females and 26% are males. So the majority of the participants considered that the coronavirus infection was life-threatening and the novel coronavirus was the deadliest of its entire species. And majority of these participants, they found it worrisome that they may get probably infected if they are put into medical rotation duties or clinical work. Around 80% of these individuals, they feared that the care and treatment in case they get contracted with the disease may not be sufficient. And majority of them also had this fear that the institution associated hospital won't be able to handle the situation in case of uncontrolled outbreak. In spite of all these negative emotions, when asked about their strategies, if they are asked to take care of the patient, almost 80% of them told they will be able to take care of the patient and they are obliged to take care of the patient. And 70% of them denied they will be skipping ward rounds in case of they've been asked to come for ward rounds in outbreak condition. So these are the two studies which have been done recently in medical college students during this COVID-19 outbreak. Both the studies show that there is a degree of anxiety and fear among medical college students during this time. One is related to the clinical postings and if they are asked to come for clinical postings. Second one is the fact that they are skipping or they are not able to do their academics as usual. Coming on to the common presentation of psychological disturbances post COVID-19. So there are few questions. Okay, how is your sleep? How is your appetite? How is your interest in doing daily work? And if in answer for any of this question is disturbed, it is a subtle indication that you are having some psychological disturbance. And these three questions, they directly deal with the problem. Okay, the past few weeks, do you experience sudden attacks of fear or anxiety occurring spontaneously? The answer for this is yes. It indicates that you are having a panic attack. Next question, for the past few weeks, do you worry excessively or getting anxious over infection or everyday problem or life-threatening circumstances and find it difficult to control it? If the answer for this is yes, which indicates that you might be having generalized anxiety disorder. The third one is, the past few weeks, are you feeling tired all the time, have lost interest or pleasure in your regular daily activities, or feeling sad most of the time? And if the answer for this is yes, it indicates that there can be a depressive disorder. You have been having some depressive symptoms. So be aware of these symptoms. And if you have experienced any of these things, try to get professional help as soon as possible. So as I mentioned, anxiety and depression are the two common presenting psychological disturbances during this COVID-19 lockdown period. Why a person should have anxiety? The foremost reason a person should have anxiety during this time is fear of infection. When we are in lockdown, we have to go out to buy articles, groceries, vegetables. We are in contact with people who deliver us these things at home. So there's a chance or fear that we might get contact infection through these things. So this fear of infection can be overwhelming and it can progress to anxiety in most of us. So what are the symptoms of anxiety? They include excessively anxious and worrying, fatigue, restlessness, increased muscle aches or soreness, impaired concentration, irritability, and difficulty in having sleep. So if you have any of these symptoms, it's indicative of anxiety. But we can prevent this fear of infection from progressing to anxiety. That is by, as a medical student, we should have adequate knowledge about the disease. What are the symptoms of the disease? How it is getting transmitted? How to prevent the transmission? Which are the symptoms which are innocuous? And what are the danger signs? If we have this adequate knowledge about the illness, we can prevent this fear of infection from progressing to anxiety. Second one is, due to social distancing and lockdown, we are confined to our homes. So almost 50 days, most of us are confined to our home. and it can lead to frustration and boredom. And if frustration boredom gets overwhelming, it can lead to stress reactions and depression. So common symptoms of depression include feeling of sad or empty, fatigue and lack of energy, loss of interest in your daily activities, no pleasure in any activities, feeling of hopelessness, worthlessness, helplessness, feeling of excessively guilty, inability to have proper sleep, poor appetite, poor memory, concentration, irritability, anger. So these things are the common symptoms of depression. But we can prevent this frustration and boredom from progressing to the stress reactions and depression by being in contact with our family and friends, either in person, phone or by computer, maintaining our daily routines, creating a sense of order, engaging in activities like reading, music, gardening, etc. So, these things we'll be discussing in detail in the future slides, but these are the ways and means by which the frustration and boredom of lockdown can be prevented from progressing to stress reactions or depression. So now coming on to certain warning signs which you need to be aware of. Preoccupation with yourself, that is a warning sign. Not engaging with others, sense of insecurity, risk-taking behavior, especially not maintaining personal hygiene, social distancing. These things can produce some complications. Afraid of leaving home because of contracting the infection, that is a warning sign. Worried about the health and that of family members. It is quite common to be worried about your health and family members, but if it is crossing the normalcy, then it can be a warning sign. Feeling of boredom, loneliness, sadness, aggression. So the lockdown can produce any of these things. And irritability towards the siblings and other family members. As we are confined to our home for the 50 days, we are no other move but to be in contact with them on a day-to-day basis. 24 hours, you have to face them, family members, siblings. So it's quite natural to develop irritability. To further worsen the matter, we lose contact with our friends from school, college, or universities because of this close time. So this irritability can be a warning sign. Starting to use tobacco, cannabis, alcohol to handle boredom, loneliness, and emotional changes. It's quite common among people who are staying in hostel or the PG accommodation, where they have inability to go return back to their home because of the lockdown. So they try to handle the boredom, loneliness by trying out alcohol, tobacco, etc. But this is a very, very important warning sign because it can lead to lots of psychiatric comorbidities. Initially, it might give you some relaxation, but in the long run, it is quite detrimental to the psychological well-being. Next is uncertainty about the examination and its impacts on the career choices can exacerbate the stress during this period. So most of us are not certain when will be the examination. The examination gets postponed. When will be the internship will start? When the internship starting is getting delayed. When will I get the completion? Whether I will be able to get into the cutoff of the time to appear for the next year's PG examination, entrance examination for the PG. So all these things can produce lots of stress during this period. The emotional behavioral changes most often than not are subtle, very subtle. A person who is a very extroverted person tend to become very silent. A person who is a very creative person blocking himself. All these things can be a sign of emotional behavioral change. Another important aspect is the excessive use of mobile and other devices. Because of the lockdown, we have lots of time to kill. We don't know how to spend our time. So most of us, we tend to use mobile and other gadgets more than usual. And that can potentially result in behavioral addiction. And once you get into this behavior addiction, it's very difficult to get out of it. So we have to ensure limited use of gadgets include healthy non-gadget activities as a part of daily routine. So to summarize, there are certain warning signs which are very important, and if it is present, it's needed urgent professional help. You need to sought urgent professional help. These include behavioral or emotional changes which last for more than 2 weeks, death wishes associated ideas, hopelessness and attempts of self-harm, and any use of alcohol or any other substance. If any of these four is present, you need to immediately seek the help of a professional. Our student counseling center, we have professionals, and the number of people whom you need to contact, I will be showing it at the end of the slides. You can take note of it and seek help if you have any of these four symptoms. During this lockdown period, parents, they also have a vital role to play in ensuring your positive and mental health. They should listen to you. They should acknowledge your difficulties. If you have any doubts, they are the person who need to clarify it. They are the person who will be reassuring you. They will be generating hope, and they have to provide emotional support in resolving various issues that you will be facing with during this period of lockdown. So, parent, their role is very, very vital, and you should be in regular contact with the parents and mingle with them and being in person-to-person contact with them. Now, coming to series suggestions about mental health well-being, how to promote mental well-being during these times. First thing is, you need to keep yourself informed. Listen to advice and recommendations from your national and local authorities. Follow only the trusted news channels such as local and national TV and radio. Don't engage yourself with various news channels. There are umpteen number of news channels, but you identify the news channel which you trust and you confine yourself to that one channel alone. The most trusted news will be coming from the WHO social media. So keep up to date with their news. So these will help you to keep informed about the illness and lockdown and other precautions, and it prevent the fear of infection from proceeding to anxiety. Next, have a routine. Get up and go to bed at similar times every day. Keep up with personal hygiene. Eat healthy meals at regular times. Exercise regularly. Allocate time for working and time for resting. And make time for doing things you enjoy. Have this routine. If you follow this routine, you will not have any boredom or frustration because of this isolation. Then minimize the news feed. A couple of slides back, I told you, keep yourself informed, but at the same time, don't keep yourself binging with news. As you are aware, there are umpteen number of news channels, and every half an hour you get breaking news. So if you try to follow each and every news and read and listen to each of these things, you will feel the anxious and distressed. So try to seek latest information and have a fixed time in a day, once or twice, and only listen to that time the news. Other times, don't try to follow the news. So minimize your news feed. It will go a great deal to minimizing your anxiety and distress. Keep up with social contact. It is very important. Keep in regular contact with people close to you by the telephone or online chats. It can be your friends, family members, or even your teachers. So keep in regular contact with them. Engage in activities. So along with the daily routine, you also have room for activities like reading, music, gardening, cooking, cleaning, washing, learning something new, which can prevent boredom. Another one important aspect is screen time. So limit your screen time. Be aware how much time you spend in front of screen every day. Make sure that you take regular breaks from on-screen activities. If you find this difficult to adhere to, download some apps which give you feedback about your screen time. It also limits your screen time. So it's very important to limit your screen time. In continuation with that, video games. I know video games can be a way to relax, but it can be tempting to spend more time on the video games because we are at home and we have lots of time to spend. But be sure to keep right balance with offline activities in your daily routine, because screen time, video games and social media, all these things can be quite addicting and can produce behavioral addiction, and once you get into behavioral addiction, as I told you earlier, it's very difficult to come out of it. Social media, I know, I mean, social media is the place for all the fake news, distressing news, hate messages, warning messages, etc. Lots of unscientific and unprofessional news that are spreading through the social media. So try to limit yourself from social media. Use your social media accounts mainly to promote positive and hopeful stories. Correct misinformation whenever you see it. As a medical student and as a person who's empowered with knowledge about this infection and virus, it is your duty to correct the misinformation wherever you see it through social media. Okay. Next, help others. If you're able to, offer support to people in your community who may be in need of help, such as helping them with food shopping, or engage yourself in volunteer activities, spread the information about the illness, means by which you can prevent contracting the illness. So various means are there to help others, and if you engage in such activities, surely the anxiety, the stress, everything will come. Support health workers. As a medical professional, it's your opportunity to help the health workers either through online or in person. You can enroll yourself in their activities in hospitals and spend your time in a productive way. This is an important aspect which we need to talk again and again. Don't drink alcohol. Don't start drinking alcohol if you have not drank alcohol in the past. If you already had, I mean, if you have the habit of taking it, limit it some amount. Avoid using alcohol drugs as a way of dealing with fear, anxiety, boredom, or social isolation. There's no evidence to suggest that drinking of alcohol can reduce the viral infection. There are lots of fake news which is spreading such falsities. In fact, the opposite is true. The harmful use of alcohol is associated with increased risk of infection, and it will worsen the treatment outcomes. So be aware of the fact that alcohol and drug use may prevent you from taking sufficient precautions to prevent yourself against infection, and it will impair the compliance with hand hygiene and social distancing, etc. So whatever may be, try avoiding any drug or any alcohol, drug or any substances during this time. And don't discriminate. I know fear is a normal reaction in the situation of uncertainty. But sometimes this fear is expressed in a way which is hurtful to others. So don't discriminate against people because you fear they may be spreading the virus. Don't discriminate against people who you think may be having the virus. Don't discriminate against health workers who are in contact with people with coronavirus. And this COVID-19, it has affected people from many countries, races and religions. So don't attribute it to any specific groups. So these are various means by which we will be able to minimize psychiatric comorbidities and promote our mental health. Final part of the presentation is managing stress. As you are aware, this is the period where most of us are under severe stress as a medical student, as a health professional, as a general public. All of us are under stress. So there are various means by which we can manage our stress. It can be coping, reframing, planning, relaxation, mindfulness, and positive self-affirmation. Let us look at it in detail. First one is coping. Coping is a cognitive or behavioral effort someone have to put in to manage a troubled person-environment relationship. At present, we are in a troubled person-environment relationship. There's a lockdown, there's isolation. We are not able to do our activities independently as we wish to. So this is a period of troubled person-environment relationship. Before going to positive way of coping, let me warn you about unhealthy ways of coping with stress. Though these unhealthy ways of coping with stress can be easy to perform and it produces a reduction of stress, but it is very temporary means and it will produce damage in the long run. Some of these unhealthy ways of coping are substance use or use of medications, overeating or undereating, withdrawing from friends, family and activities, sleeping too much, procrastinating, and taking out your stress on others like anger outbursts, physical violence, etc. Instead of these unhealthy ways of coping, there are lots of healthy ways of coping. It includes going for a walk, spending time in nature, calling a good friend, sweating it out with a good workout, writing in your journal, taking a long bath, playing with your pet, working with your garden, getting a warm cup of coffee or a tea, reading a good book, listening to music, or watching a comedy series. So these are the healthy ways of coping with stress. Second one is reframing. Reframing is actually a mental activity which involves looking at a situation, a negative situation or a stressor, and trying to reframe it or explain it in a more positive and neutral way. It helps them tap into the benefits of the stressor, and it helps them evaluate the pros and cons, positives and negatives of any situation. For example, rather getting stressed out about the lockdown period, look at it as an opportunity to pause and regroup. Make it as an opportunity to master your weak subjects and enjoy some alone time. So by this way, we are able to reframe the negative situation and able to extract positivity in such situations. This is called reframing, and this will help us in a great deal in managing these stressors. Next one is planning. Proper planning can minimize stress. Maintain a proper daily checklist, each morning work task, household task, and activities. All these things can be planned and can organize it on a weekly basis. This will help you in managing your stress. There are various relaxation strategies which tap the self-regulation strength of each of us. It will help us in maintaining our relaxation and prevent the stress. It involves taking control of your breathing, creating a great feeling of calmness in your body physiology, and it will produce positive impact on your racing mind and your worrisome thoughts of the days. So various strategies which we can try out is, one is deep breathing exercise, where you can breathe in and breathe out in a very calm and slow manner and concentrating on each breathing in and breathing out, meditation, yoga, and physical exercise. Lots of studies have shown that a walk, brisk walk for half an hour to 20 minutes can help you in relaxing your body and mind. And that relaxation will be persistent throughout the day. So do physical exercise. These are various means of relaxing yourself. Next one is mindfulness. It's a state of intentional, non-judgmental focus on the present moment. So it includes various elements. First one is awareness, where we are tuned into what is happening in the present moment, including the sight, sound, smell, or physical sensation, usually which you will be ignoring it. Then focusing your attention on the present moment without thinking about the past or future events. Accepting things as it comes, without feeling or thinking, after trying to judge it or trying to change it for yourself. Or observing things, like experiencing unpleasant sensation, thoughts, feelings, which can be temporary and fleeting, and observing them objectively without reaction or judgment. So these are various strategies by which you can be in a state of non-judgmental present. Okay, so it will cut down all the thoughts which produces stress, and it will relax you in a very high way. Once you master this mindfulness, nothing can produce stress in you. And finally, positive self-affirmation. It's always good to have a journal or a notebook where you write things positive about yourself. Writing about character strengths and about positive affirmations of your strengths can be helpful in reminding yourself of your strengths. So when you are in a very distressed or sad phase, if you are able to go through your self-affirmation notebook, things which is positive about you, good about you, it will produce a sense of relaxation and calm, and you will be able to manage the stress. For example, you can write things like, I am a kind and fair-minded person when I go out of me to help my work colleagues when they are struggling. Such kind of positive, I am a very brave person. When my classmate is bullied, I went and helped him get out of the bullies. I am a smart person, I am a creative person, etc. So all these things, if you are able to write it down, and if you read it after a point, it will help you in relaxing and making your mind happy. So these are the various strategies by which you can manage your stress. So I need to acknowledge my postgraduates with Instructor Swapna and Ashley to help me present compiling this presentation. And these are the references of my presentation. Thank you.